In the first place, let us have a clear idea of what a Dharani is. And again, keeping in mind that this is an explanation by a Westerner. Now, he's a devout Buddhist. It's clear he's a devout Buddhist, but you know whether this would be the kind of explanation that a either a Buddhist master of the past, frankly, or one of more contemporary commentary would agree with or not, I don't know. I usually just simply think of a Dharani as a form of a mantra. But what he says is, it is a more or less meaningless chain of words or names that is supposed to have a magical power in helping the one who is repeating it at some time of extremity. It may be very short, like the Sanskrit word om, which the Tibetans repeat ad infinitum, or it may be very long, like this one we are now considering, or the one in the Lankavatara Sutra. Generally, however, they are quite short, like the one in the Prajnaparamita Hridaya Sutra, which is Gate Gate Paragate Parasamgate Bodhisvaha. A Dharani is supposed to embody the quintessence of the spiritual power emanating from some great teacher or spiritual benefactor. It is a kind of carrier for spiritual radioactivity, an appeal for absent treatment. A great master or bodhisattva gives his instructions under quiet conditions with a sincere purpose of enlightening and benefiting his disciples. But in times of extremity, when his master is absent and the disciple feels his strength failing, he is encouraged by repeating the name and words of his master. Doubtless there is a measure of superstition in its practice, but there is also a great deal of practical usefulness and provable value in it. And it's the fact that he considers it to have value, in spite of the fact that he omitted it, is the reason why I'm reading this particular description by Goddard. He says, all religions have had their Dharani. The Pure Land Buddhists repeat Namo Amitabha Buddha more or less constantly. The Nichiren Buddhists repeat Nemo Myoho Renge Kyo, in which case its repetition holds the mind to the superlative spiritual power inherent in the lotus of the wonderful Dharma scripture. The Mohammedans repeat in the same fashion the words Allah is one God and Mohammed is his prophet. Christians, whether they are conscious of it or not, in repeating the Lord's Prayer, are repeating a Dharani in which they have implicit faith. They are not thinking so much of the meaning of the words as they are voicing their faith in the supernal power of the Heavenly Father. Catholics have a number of these Dharani, the Paternoster, Ora Pro Nobis, and Ave Maria, for instance. Even the benediction, quote, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen, close quote, and the various creeds, the Nicene, the Alexandrian, are used as Dharani, as is seen by the fact of the general dislike of altering or amending them. In omitting this long Dharani, therefore, we are not deprecating the great reality of the spiritual power that it symbolizes, nor are we denying its practical usefulness in serving to concentrate the mind's attention. In fact, in thus explaining at length why we omit it, we are emphasizing its basic value in holding a disciple's attention to the true source of power, in which by this practice of repeating Dharani, he is identifying his spirit. Our sutra is wholly given up to establishing the fact that this boundless potentiality of spiritual power is resident in the mind's pure essence, to which all appeal, whether in calm or in tempest, should be made.